Perfect. And I say just very simple welcome on behalf of the organization. Welcome on the two seminar project. Basically, I already introduced last time the project, a little bit about the history of the project. It started from a series of conversations between me and three artists, Chong Ang, Falke Pisano, Camilla Sposati, and Sarah van der Heijden. It was a beginning group of the project, and we actually discussed the possibility of updating, making a more contemporary version of contemporary understanding of Roland Barthes' text on the seminar. So the seminar as a kind of rethinking the current situation of education, rethinking the three notions that are really significant for Barthes, the notion of institution, the notion of text, and the notion of transference, and what is actually the relationship between them. For Barthes, it's very clear there's a kind of dynamic relationship. If you want to have a seminar situation, it's really important to have a kind of dynamic entanglement where all these things are acting together. So these three artists were invited to develop a proposition starting from one of the perspectives, from the perspective of text, from the perspective of institution, and from the perspective of transference. Parallel to that, we invited three other artists because we think from the perspective of activation, of seminar as a verb. So for that reason, we invited three artists to develop activated projects, seminars that were taking place here. So Koelewijn is one of the artists who developed with students from the Macro series of readings. In the Avenir last two weeks, organized a series of performative events, and they were recorded and now are part of the exhibition, so they integrated in the display system. The work is now on video. And the coming 2 weeks, René Francisco is coming and doing another 2 weeks of workshop, and that will be also part of the exhibition. And additionally, we invited three other artists making a kind of more contextual statement. Jeremiah Day, who's doing the poster outside, Mick Wilson, who is also part of this evening, did a sound piece that you will sometimes hear when it's coming from the speakers. And Sarah Pierce is going to do a performance later in the period. Of course, this is Bach, and we think it's really important to have also public meetings discussing topics. So from all the, let's say, perspectives, we invited artists to join the evening and to discuss on specific topics from one of the angle points of the triangle. So tonight, we're going to discuss the perspective of the text, conceiving it from the relationship between institution and transference. For this, we invited Falke Pisano and Mick Wilson and Job Koelewijn, who are all part of the exhibition. And we invited Vivian Rehberg from Piet Zwart Institute, the director of the MA Final Program, to moderate this evening. So, Vivian, very welcome.
I'll try not to push any buttons here or step on any cables that will destroy the technical infrastructure or spill the water. Falke knows that I'm very clumsy. I feel like we should start, because it's such a beautiful day, with the very last paragraph of To the Seminar, which is To the Seminar, to thank you all for giving up on the first real summer day in the Netherlands. And Barthes makes this dedication to the seminar. To the seminar, this expression must be understood as a locative, as an encomium, like the one the poet von Schober and the composer Schubert addressed an die Musik, and as a dedication. So thank you for coming. As Hank mentioned, I'm just going to give a really brief introduction and then introduce the speakers, but it's really difficult and almost nonsensical to isolate text from the other elements that come together to compose the essay to the seminar, those other elements being institution and transference. Barthes describes all of them as spaces, so that's something that they share in common. To the seminar precedes by 3 years the moment when the seminar would cease to be the principal format for Barthes' teaching, when his courses were moved to the less intimate setting of the Collège de France lecture hall. It's fair to say that in To the Seminar, the text is disentangled from writing or the written document, and from the author, whom Barthes declared dead a decade prior in his 1967 essay, Death of the Author. There, Bacht writes that it is necessary to overthrow the author myth in order to give writing its future, famously declaring that the birth of the reader must be at the expense of the death of the author. Into the seminar, texts are co-constituted through the body's present, through the topology of corporeal relation. He exposes the textual as a space that is performed and embodied, perhaps akin to an exhibition, and maybe we'll talk about that as well. The book, says Bacht, is analogous to a conversation. Texts are declared to be practices rather than products, and the seminar either assumes the responsibility for producing a text, or the seminar regards its own non-functional practice as already constituting a text, one which does not appear in writing. The text is not a destination for the seminar, worse yet, an outcome, preconceived to be evaluated as these days in our educational environments. It is not immobile, it rustles, like much of Bacht's thoughts and his fragmentary writing. The order for the evening will be three speakers, one following the other. I'm going to read the bios in alphabetical order because that's how they're presented to me. But first we'll have Falke Pisano, and then we'll have Job Koelewijn, and then Mick Wilson. Other way around, sorry. Then we'll have Mick Wilson, and finally Job Koelewijn. Job Koelewijn's work, ranging from installations to photography and multiples, invites the use of hearing and smelling to heighten optical experiences. He studied at the Gerrit Rietveld Academy and the Sandberg Institute, both in Amsterdam, after which he held a residency at PS1 Contemporary Art Center in New York. Among other prizes, he was awarded the prestigious Dr. A.H. Heineken Prize for Art in 2006. Recently, his work has been exhibited in various solo exhibitions in Zurich, in Tilburg, and recent group shows include On Sein Wow in Amsterdam, Broken White at the Van Abbe Museum, and the First Asia Biennial Fifth Guangzhou Triennial in 2015, and he works and lives in Amsterdam. Falke Pisano is here with Camilla Sposati, and I'm going to introduce them both because their work is both in the exhibition, and we'll have the occasion also to ask them both questions. Falke Pisano is an artist whose installations, sculptures, drawings, diagrams, and speech performances explore the potential of language as an emancipatory tool that enables individuals to responsibly and critically make themselves part of the world. In 2013, she won the Prix de Rome, and in 2016, she was an artist in residence at M4 Gastatelier in Amsterdam. Her recent exhibition projects include The Value in Mathematics, which was shown in Karlsruhe, in Zelm, and in Los Angeles, among other locations, The Body in Crisis at the Showroom in London and the Vleishall in Middelburg, and she's participated in the 20th Biennial of Sydney, the Istanbul Biennial in 2013, the 53rd Venice Biennial in 2009, and Manifesto 7 in Trentino in 2008. It says here that she lives and works in Berlin, but I think that's not true. She lives and works in Sao Paulo. Yeah. Camilla, who is sitting on the left of Falke, is an artist who works in several mediums, including sculpture, installation, photography, and projections. Combining elements of geology, archaeology, and chemistry, her work examines processes on microscopic as well as global scales, such as the growth of crystals in laboratories or the geological changes of the Earth's crust. She obtained her MA in fine art from Goldsmiths, and was artist in residence at M4 Gastatelier in Amsterdam. Recent exhibitions and biennials include 10th Mercosul Biennial in 2015, the Bahia Biennial in Salvador, Tomi Otaka Correspondencias in Sao Paulo, and Earth's Earth in New York. And Camilla lives also and works in Sao Paulo. And last but not least is Mick Wilson, who's an artist, educator, researcher, and writer. He's been head of the Valland Academy, University of Gothenburg, since 2012, and has been active in developing doctoral education projects across the arts, and as an editor-in-chief and a member of the European Artistic Research Network, ERN.
Edited volumes include, among others, The Curatorial Conundrum with Paul O'Neill and Lucy Steeds in 2016, Share Handbook for Artistic Research Education in 2013, and Curating in the Educational Turn, again with Paul O'Neill in 2010. Recent projects and exhibitions include Aesthetic Jam Taipei Biennial, Joyful Wisdom at the Risen Has Museum in Istanbul, and The Judgment is the Mirror at the Living Art Museum in Reykjavik. Mick lives and works in Gothenburg and Dublin. Just a brief note, occasionally Mick's sound piece will appear during the presentations, and so we just ask the speakers to not try to speak over it and just allow it to fill the room and, and we'll listen and enjoy, and then you can take up your talking again. Okay, thank you, Falke.
Great. So, yeah, it's nice that the light is out. This is not my slideshow. As Vivian said, I'm Falke Pisano, thank you for coming. As Vivian said, I work together in this work with Camilla Sposacci, but I take on now the responsibility for giving my version of the work, let's say it like that. I try to, of course, include both of our ideas. It might be a bit of a messy introduction, even if I wrote it out. I think what I wanted to say before is that I think in relation to the notion of text in the text of seminar, maybe what can be something to keep in mind is that I have the feeling that the way that we have been working has a lot to do with either unworking or reworking certain texts on which we are writing our future text. So I think this is something that already was present in my work and in Camilla's work before we start to work together. So I will start the introduction with just to show like one or two works of Camilla and myself to give a bit of a context as to why we thought it would be a good idea to work together, even if our practices are not the most important reason. So I start with some of my works. My latest series of works, The Value in Mathematics, deals with the relation between culture and mathematics. In 10 chapters, I investigated how Western cultural values, such as progress, rationality, and universality, have influenced the way we have come to think about mathematics. Some of the works that I made in this series question the past and present position of the so-called advanced mathematics, and others investigate the possibility of the existence of other forms of mathematics which are informed by different cultural values and practices. The series consists of sculptures such as this one, which title is Fragmentizing What Seems Universal and Continuous, but also videos which were developed through conversations, of which you see some stills here. The video is actually called The Value in Mathematics Language. So it's also about language. It talks a lot about what kind of language do we use to describe mathematics, but also when we include cultural considerations of mathematics, what kind of language do we use then? Do we go to an anthropological language? How do we use notions of ethno, these kind of things? This is a work by Camilla, Earth Anatomical Theater, which is an adaptation, or as she likes to also call it, a misreading of the 16th century Italian model of observation of the body, the Anatomical Theater in Padua. This theater is excavated behind the ruined facade of a colonial mansion on the island of Itaparica in the northeast of Brazil. The theater is constructed mostly subterraneous and with a rough and open finishing. The architecture drove the attention to the earth and wall instead of directing the gaze to the dead body at the center. So the scientific model became a frame for speculating on history and what other ways we could think about history. When she was excavating the hole for this theater, this ceramic fragment was found there. And it's very funny because it depicts a rabbit or a parrot. It's on how you see it. Of course, it depicts one of them, but you can see both. And this image plays a role in the film that Camilla is developing, which will reflect on the way that the perspective images of Brazil and Europe have been intertwined and are still intertwined. But putting the work aside, basically this project developed from us living together, living with each other's practice and the daily conversations we were having. We would regularly realize that we have different readings, different perspectives and interpretations of things. And we would talk quite often, not directly about colonialism. Well, I forgot to say, yeah, Camilla is Brazilian, but maybe Vivian already said, and I'm Dutch. Not about colonialism directly, but about certain perspectives and interpretations of relations, misunderstandings as well, that have to do with this history. We also realize that there exists a certain entanglement between the understanding of the self and the other. This exists when we think of the other as simply anyone that is not oneself, but it is also present in the historical relation between Brazil and Europe. We can look at images like this, for instance, something that we did. Some of the earliest images of Brazil were produced by European reports of the 17th and 18th century. These reports had the double agenda of scientific documentation and the promotion of colonization. Well, this does not maybe exactly promote the colonization, but this does this more. In Brazil, these images are well known. They play a role in the way Brazil has understood itself, and in a sense, they still do. They played a role, and they are still present. One of the conversations we were having revolved around the question whether it is possible to turn it around as well. To not only think about how Brazilians understand each other through these images that were a colonial production of knowledge, but also what if we think about the European colonial expansion not only as a quest for land, knowledge, power, resources, but also as a quest for self-understanding? Can we then look at images like this as a way of trying to understand the self in the other, to understand what one is through encountering differences, to understand what one desires? What does this change of perspective do? So one of the things that we would talk about, because this is Frans Post, it's a Dutch painter. What is very interesting, the skies in Brazil don't look like this. So there's the nature also not exactly, but there's a really interesting thing of Dutch painters that actually paint the skies of the Netherlands in a Brazilian setting. So we thought this was, anyway, it triggered some things. Anyway, like with thinking about this changing of perspective, while still thinking about the colonial context, we realized that we were dealing with complicated and tricky questions. So when the invitation of Henk came to be part of an exhibition, a seminar, it seemed the perfect context to expand our conversations, to set up a long-term research project, to open up our conversations to other people, and to create a situation that would enable us to learn from the people we spoke with and with them, of course, as well. So what we did was we decided to structure the project around Lundu. It's a dance. And what we present here in this space is really the beginning of the research, so it's really a first chapter or first phase. So when we talk about Lundu, Lundu is a style of Afro-Brazilian music and dance that developed through the exchange of African, Bantu, Spanish, and Portuguese people in Brazil in the 18th century. And this all, like when I describe it like this, I know Camilla does not really like so much this very sort of factual talking about it, because in fact, we don't know how it exactly developed. So I think this is an interesting thing of having different methods of research and thinking. So it's but what we know is that it's a dance of seduction and pleasure performed by one or two couples. It was, according to Mario de Andrade, the first Afro-Black musical form to be disseminated among all classes of Brazilians and become a national music. In the late 18th and early 19th century, it had become one of the most important genres of dance and song in Brazil, but also on the Iberian Peninsula. So why did we decide to focus our research on Lundu, on this very historical subject somehow? Lundu developed, obviously, in a colonial context, through a process of exchange and influence, and the physical, sensible engagement that accommodated this exchange and influence. We thought that maybe through this dance and music, through the body, we could find a way to think outside of binaries of exploitation and domination, that we could engage with the body in micro and macro sense as a way to understand complexity, the complexity and the singularity of relations, not to soften or whitewash colonialism, of course not, but exactly to investigate how this still influences perspectives. We had the impression that even in thought that has been influenced by post-colonial discourse, or even that is very influenced or a part of post-colonial discourse, there sometimes exists a dynamic that is not immune to reproducing certain aspects of colonial perspectives, and we thought that we might find some way of making small breaks in this through departing from dance and music. Still, for this chapter, we did not learn to dance, we did not investigate all the music that still exists today, because different forms still exist today. Instead, we decided to begin with two images. So these. It's two historical illustrations of Lundu by a German painter, Rugendas, from 1835. Why would we start a research about the dance and the music through these historical images? Well, Camilla came to know about Lundu, as far as I know, through the image. So, linearly speaking, it was the starting point before the project existed. But this is not the only reason. The images confronted us with the frameworks that determine our reading and probably also would determine our approach to the Lundu itself. So the image became a kind of, for me at least, a kind of space of friction, of a mirror maybe, a confrontation of in what ways do we read these images. It laid out for us questions about modern representation, about history, about the interpretation of relations that were necessary to deal with. At the same time, we thought that something in these historical images might be able to fracture or comment on the very thorough establishment of otherness in modern representation and its reproduction in critique. So we started from these images to have conversations about these images, about the Lundu, but through these images with different people. We spoke to Fabiana Dotra Brito, is here on the university campus of the University of Salvador. She's a dancer, choreographer, and dance theorist. With her we spoke, or she spoke with us, about the non-linearity of relations, of co-implication, the state of being entangled with not only another, but also with the environment. She spoke about the problem of writing a history of dance. She was telling us how it is not possible, even if you want to write a history of dance, it's not possible to construct a history by going back and taking the way again. You have to go forward and understand change as a process to understand what possibly happened in the past. We spoke to André Rangel, a musician and instrument maker. This is also in Salvador. He spoke about the way the relation of the musician to the instrument influences the changes that take place in music. He spoke about the dominance of Western pitch, rhythm, and dynamics in the reading and listening of music. For instance, he's talked about syncopation, which is defined as a disturbance or an interruption of the regular flow of rhythm. And syncopation is one of the things that is considered specific to the lundu. And he said, like, well, but why it's only syncopation? Because it disturbs something that has been established as a structure, where this is not established, it's not syncopation, something like this. And then what I very much liked is was talking about music to retrieve something that we lost, and the possibility of taking natural resources, goods of value, out of capitalist circulation, about the importance of not holding or possessing anything. We also spoke with Denise Ferreira da Silva, who's a theorist, and she pointed us towards thinking about abandon, or she made clear that it is indeed necessary to abandon the logic of discovery and the thrill of the evidence, to not see the image as evidence in which we can, you know, forensically find what happened there, but that it was important to imagine otherwise, to imagine in relation to that of that part of the image which is only available as excess, that exceeds colonial expropriation and modern representation. She, she's quite well known, maybe, she talked about how black and white bodies are produced by racial knowledge, how the black subject throughout in post-Enlightenment texts has been produced as outer determined, and the white subject as self-determined. The white subject as self-determined, free, self-producing, self-knowing, with access to rights, knowing its rights. This subject could not have been produced without the other. This is with her. And so what she is doing in her practice, which becomes quite speculative as well, she tries to imagine tools that are able to break through the form of the white European subject. Well, she's really interesting to read. So on the basis of these conversations and the conversations that we continue to have between us, we made the video and the objects in this space here. These videos. That's Lewis's daughter. We see the objects as instruments rather than discrete objects of art, as ways of mediating some of the content of conversations that we've been having towards new conversations, which we then again will attempt to mediate to others through new objects. So what we did here the last days, we've also had some conversations. Barbara to write some things on the object. So we spoke to Wouter Kapitein, who is a musicologist at ASCA. We spoke because he wrote a text about Edward Said's position on popular music and how it does not really correspond to all his other thinking, actually. We spoke about thinking from music instead of thinking from theory. So what can music give to theory instead of what can theory give to music? We spoke with Galit about self-perception in relation to the environments we move in and our working process. We spoke with Barbara Alves about the role of the image in the project. This is why I tried to be more precise, and because it was not so clear to her, why are you looking at this image if you're actually trying to research a dance? She was a bit confused about what we were doing in the beginning. And we talked about the conditions of research and their articulation in the work. So for her it was difficult, I think it's good to say, for her it was difficult to understand. She was asking why we would not only focus on the image, but we would meander a bit. But I think this is like one of the conditions of this research, or one of the important things of this research for us, is to be very open to what comes on our way, to keep things open and not really focus on things, but to look for the friction as well. So this is now I have like a little text still, which is maybe a bit more, I don't know, complicated. So one of the other things that we did is make this diagram, which is outside on the wall there. And I will just quickly read something that I wrote to Camilla some months ago about what I thought we were doing and what I also thought she probably agreed with. I think she did. So I wrote to me. So I was right. I think that it is a good approach to not produce or strengthen an apparatus or discourse with a self-confirming structure or anything that can be used for any collective position, self-interest, comfort, security. With collective position, I mean a position that moves towards consolidation, internal legitimation, a position that rejects co-implication. So I think we need to insist in and perform incompleteness, the necessity of doubting our own positions, not defining our positions as fixed, the possibility of conflicting readings against the idea that we are reading a truth or a new objective reality of the image. This opens up a space for confrontation, exaggeration, humor, misreading, imagining past, responsible imagination, etc. We can also think if we want to reinforce anyone or anything in our readings. Not the position of the exploited, not the position of the non-Western, because that would still position the Western as one and the rest as other. Maybe this could be the divided self. So, yeah, so it was a little bit messy probably, but do you want to have any questions? Do you have any questions?
I've already broken. Okay, there we go. I've already broken the technology. It would be, so the idea is that we open the floor to questions after each speaker. I'm on this side and Anna's on the other side with 4 minutes. We have 4 minutes. On the other side with a microphone, just so you know, that's the protocol. And I would ask the room first if there are any pressing questions or comments.
What I think is really interesting is in the beginning of your presentation, you mentioned the writing of the future text, and that's, of course, a very significant Bartesian quotation. So can you a little bit more tell about how you understand this writing of the future text? Is this related to the thinking for music? How do you, let's say, understand the way you treat this future of the text, writing the future text?
God, now I put Bart in the conversation. I think the reason why I mentioned this is because I think that, as I understood the writing of this text, it's not a written it does not have to be. A written text can be a non-functional. It's the practice of things. It's not towards establishing something as there exists already, as the text of history, the text of humanity, the text of the text that also have established our subjectivities in a way. This, I think, is something that got very much from Denise. And I think, in a way, through thinking about the body, or thinking through the body or thinking with the body, we had the feeling that there was a delay. There's a possibility of building in a delay for, I don't know how you say it, that the coding or the inscribing in these texts is delayed in any case. So, but I think this also happens when you have voices that do not completely fit, when you have voices that by having a conversation become more and more fragmented. So I think this was really the main thing that why we thought that would be good, that this would fit here, is that there's no way that we are going to create any kind of consistent, coherent discourse. There's no way that we are going to come out with something that has only one position, because we're very different. We include more people that have more different positions. So it's more of a kind of making sure that it's impossible to that this future text is going to be a text that is institutional. And I think this is one of the most, for me, I think this must be one of the most important things of seminars to really prevent this establishing, I think, these days. Maybe not every moment, but.
Anne?
One more, I think.
One more question.
Hi. Falke, can you elaborate a little bit on how, and it's perfectly okay when it's in formal terms, how the three sculptures were conceived?
Let me go back to the... Yeah, because I didn't talk at all about the objects, because I thought it was... So these are three objects. They can be... they're flexible in a way. This the object that is on the left, we actually started working on as a series of drawings in which we would try to imagine different positions in the image. So we tried to sort of access the space of the image, because these images have very strict organization. So everyone is there for a reason. So we wanted to try to break this specific directions of looking that were in the image. And then there's a kind of organization, like the images are a collage, and there's a kind of organization that was provoked in me as a sort of natural organization. So the women on the left are together speaking. There is on the right, there's a certain absurdity, but on the right there is like the women's talking and kind of either Protestant Inquisition people in the back, which are probably European. It's like there are certain unconscious ways of recombining images as well. And I thought this was something to confront myself and people with. So that is why we made it as an image that can confront the body somehow. There's this image in the back. It's a kind of writing tool and conversation tool in which we propose five ways of trying to break either the image or to make more space in the image, to resist certain readings of object and subject relations, or of colonial relations, or of so we try to develop, and also later we yesterday we talked with this Barbara about this, like how can we develop certain tools or certain notions that help us break our presuppositions somehow. The other images. Which is it's a work called co-implication. They can move into each other, can move out of each other. One has an image of dance and music, and the other has an image of the environment. This had to do with the idea that we talked about with Fabiana Breto, that you cannot exclude the environment, that everything is very determined by the environment and where it takes place. So we wanted to show how people, environment, music, how everything is co-implicated, how everything is entangled in each other. And actually, we just thought, we really think of the image, we want to create much more objects, just to talk with people. It's quite an intuitive process, I think, but I see like a whole big space with all kind of strange images that can somehow, that come from conversations and that produce new conversations. It's a bit vague, but does it answer a little bit?
Okay. We'll have plenty of time after the final talk to ask lots of questions. So if you have more questions, please hold them. And I will, thank you, Falke.
Okay.
We can bring... Just in time. Well, Mick will set up while we hear his sound piece.
If you just put it here. Hi. So what I have to present is a little bit disjointed. This is what I'm going to try to do, is just piece together some of the strands that informed the choice to put this particular song, Donal Óg, into the context of the two seminar. So I'm going to begin with the seminar text that we were given as a kind of prompt. One of the things that strikes me about Barthes' kind of image of the seminar is that it is, as he indicates, a kind of a utopian idea, and there's a certain amount of a romanticism about the institution of the seminar. And I'm thinking it's important to register the kind of context of 1970s, 1980s. Elite French intellectual university culture, and how important a crucible that has been for much of the critical resources that we use within the contemporary art world. I mean, if Rancière, Deleuze, Foucault, Derrida. So I think part of what I was interested in was to disrupt to resist this romanticism of the seminar. And one of the things that strikes me as important about the seminar is that it is a relatively recent form. It's something that emerges in the context of the 19th century German university reforms. And one of the particular moments of the development of the seminar is Ranke's historical source criticism seminar. And what's interesting about this is that the seminar emerges as a particular practice of orality and textuality intertwined, where there's a training of historians in the craft of discerning the critical weight or valuation of a text. So we could go so far as to argue that the idea of the text is a production of the seminar form. So seminars do not convene to read texts. Seminars convene to produce the very category of text. That's overstating it, but there is something in that. And it is interesting to register the displacement of an older academic form, what's here referred to as the disputatio, which was a prioritizing of oral production, of spontaneous oral performance, over the question of textual production to demonstrate a mastery of the canon. So there were issues of mastery, but it was to be demonstrated through oral performance. And what I'm trying to get at is that the tangle of orality and textuality shifts. It's not that there's a primary orality that is displaced by textuality, but rather there's a change in the modes of entanglement. So that was one kind of consideration. A second consideration is, given the way in which Henk specifically framed to seminar as an intervention in relation to an existing kind of discourse to the educational turn, for me, it's been an important trajectory in my own practice as an educator, as somebody reflecting on the conditions of contemporary practice, and as a practitioner, to map the shift from a turn to discourse as a mode of practice. So not discursive production as ancillary or secondary to the production of art, but rather discursivity as itself the primary artistic productive mode. And this is something that, you know, I've talked at length about elsewhere. And I see the turn to education, which is, again, something that I've been involved in mapping, this turn to education as a mode of artistic and curatorial practice, as a moment within this broader turn to discursivity. And one of the things that I have been concerned in my own practice in responding to that is the way in which a particular priority seems to me to have been given to a notion of kind of public sphere type notions of discursivity and the dialogical. So prioritizing essentially questions of meaning making and of the dialogue between partners engaged in a conversation where they seek shared understanding. And in contrast to that, I've been interested in the suasive dimensions of utterance. So this is an area of rhetoric which focuses on the well, Barthes would say the grain of the voice. So what you hear now over the microphone, the my blocked nose, the funny resonance of my voice, not so all that stuff which is both a material force that exceeds my body but is embodied and yet is something that is not fully available to me even as I pretend to describe my voice to you. The conceit of imagining that I can describe my voice that you hear better than I do, but I will tell you what my voice sounds like. So this funny knot of embodied voicing and utterance, and how that dimension of the kind of phatic in utterance was somehow being displaced quite often in these modes that focused on the question of discursivity. So some of the things that I was drawing upon in thinking about this were simple vernacular things. So in the kind of Dublin Irish English that I learned to speak, there's a lot of utterances that have a very strong, what I would now call a performative dimension, but at the time just registered as a strength. So for example, if one was in a discussion with someone where they were talking about their art practice and they were getting very full of themselves and elaborating quite a lot of detail and maybe demonstrating a certain pretentiousness, one would challenge that by saying, "Ah, here." And the "ah, here" is a summoning to be here, to be in this place, in this moment, summoned by the voice to attend to this world that we share together and to interrupt whatever kind of getting lost inside one's own subjective echo chamber. "I hear." And this stuff, I use the term performative, but actually I think this is something a little bit different than the performative. This is not simply a question of doing something with language. This action of language is somehow constituting the subjectivities in play. So it's more than a question of an act upon intersubjectivity, it is a question of constituting it. Here! So another source of this is, sorry, take me a moment. Another source of this is to do with religious uses of language and how they become secularized. And I'm just going to play you a short couple of seconds from an Irish song called Allelu na Gauna. And the Allelu that you hear there is the Hallelujah, Hallelujah, praise God. Except here, Allelu na Gauna is calling in the cattle. So this is summoning the animals home. This is not a worship.
Shagling share no gona, lalu no gona, no goa no bona, lalu no gona, no gona be the parluam.
So what interests me there is the way in which a particular religious modality is secularized, and the part that's secularized, because Allelu is not calling, Allelu, praise be God, is not calling for a response from God, but it is actually to do with the way in which the Allelu was encoded into the Gregorian Mass, where it became part of a call and response. And it's through that usage that the idea of Allelu as meaning I'm calling, I'm hailing you, becomes secularized and becomes a calling of animals. So I'm going to jump forward a bit here. But these interests in the question of utterance beyond the question of discursivity and in relation to the potencies of vocalization brought me to a series of works, this series is called Rhetor, Rhetoric, Orator, Rhetor, and it deals with this question of utterance as embodiment and not simply the performative as familiarly known. This work involves producing texts, producing installation, and producing recordings, and also live performance. So I just want to play you one of the pieces of work from this strand of activity.
Commenter the whole rantalo, Marienter now on a ramle tor doing in you, Agas Madun Arvika, Marwahmid of a Kuna Fain. It's not lixing ye gau accessing olk or nahutar nah gunnei gundagudriot gunnevtar do.
Okay, so those three things, interrogating the seminar form, thinking about the question of the educational turn as a development within this turn to discursivity within contemporary practice, and an interest in a dimension of utterance that seemed to me to be being deprioritized within this. And it's out of that tangle that I turned to the song Donal Óg. And Donal Óg is... It is no singular thing. It exists in English and Gaelic. It is sung in Ireland and Scotland and around the world, wherever the Irish and Scots have migrated. It exists in multiple written forms. There are versions with 6 verses. There are versions with 17 verses. There are verses that appear in Donal Óg that appear in other songs. There are other songs which some commentators think are actually parts of Donal Óg, but now separated from it. The basic premise of the song is a woman singing her abandonment or betrayal by a lover and hailing And there's a series of hailings in the song that kind of move around in quite a strange way. The song has a very heavy-handed layer of Christian imagery, lambs, kneeling, praying in church, and so forth. But this layer sits in contrast with another layer where animals speak in the night and where the forces of nature act as forces in the world. Images that are not within a Christian theology, but in something else. And there's also a recurrent reference to the agency of the mother as the maker of prohibitions. My mother ordered that I should not see you. Or the one who determines identity. My mother will ask you to name your people. So there's a tangle within the song that indicates multiple genealogies. So there is no original or primary text. There is something that is not simply a question of the migration of an oral construction into text. The multiplying of this thing continues, so it is an unsettled thing. And what interests me about it is that I believe this question of the transfer of songs transgenerationally is doing something which Barthes' fantasy of the seminar doesn't do but wishes to do. It is operating a relationship with the production of utterance and the transfer of utterance across time, transgenerationally, but in a way that it cannot be apprehended through the typical kind of ontology of the text. Even the kind of post-structuralist, deconstructed, endlessly deferred text, or the text which we can never get outside of, etc., etc., that actually these various schemas still do not apprehend the specificity of singing bodies that sing across time. And the way in a key part of what I've been concerned to address is the way in which the question of singing has been alienated from us in such a profound way that the process of daily singing, of singing as part of the tuning of your body to the world, of tuning your body to other bodies, which is something that would have been pervasive within the European and North American cultures, which have been responsible for excluding so much of this, even within those cultures, it would have been pervasive, even, I would imagine, 50 years ago, at least a century ago. But there's this incredible absenting, this aesthetic impoverishment of our day-to-day existence, which has passed unnoticed and undeclared. And in its place, we have X factor and other kinds of ersatz ideas of virtuosity. So it's an important dimension of this to consider. What if we forego the idea of the seminar and engage instead in the idea of a sing-song? In a sing-song, there's a turn-taking around singing where virtuosity is allowed, it's just not necessitated or required in order for one to participate, but also in the process of sing-song, collective informal singing together, in that process there is all kinds of transmission and critical thinking done. And while these themes have been touched on in the past in different ways, I believe there's a particular urgency to bring the question of singing not as virtuosity, but singing just as coughing, farting, talking, going to the toilet, bringing it back into just part of the regime of bodily being that we inhabit together. And so that's where my turn to this song, Donal Óg, is. I'm not proposing that this particular instantiation of it in the gallery here does all of these things. I'm more indicating it is out of that matrix of concerns that this particular small gesture spins out. So I'll leave it there.
Who has a question?
Mick, do you sing the sound piece yourself? And it appears for me some of the piece that you do and other pieces, parts of it, I wasn't sure. And I'm just wondering what that, you know, act of actually producing the piece through your own body, through song, you know, how that works in relation to you producing your reflection on it now. I'm just curious to know about that.
It is important that it is me who's singing. Yeah. And this is not about the rehearsal of my subjectivity, but rather trying to access the idea of voice as a mode of individuation that's different from ideas of the subject.
Yeah. That's exactly what I imagined, but I would really love to hear you reflect on that actual process for you, on that actual individuation process through singing that piece, because, you know, you actively produced a certain knowledge or constituted it otherwise by doing so. So you've reflected on many of the reasons why you did this, but I'd be curious to hear you actually talk about that singing, that actual production experience in relation to what you just said, but not as a production of your subjectivity, but as a constitution of knowledge through that bodily production, which is not rhetoric in the discursive sense.
Yeah. It is this one, like, this song inhabited me. I mean, this is another dimension of it, that in singing it, I've sung this, my partner is about to leave me. No, I'm joking, but I've sung this so often, it inhabited, and to the point where I began to understand that this transmissions that are here within this indicate transgenerational agency by something other than human subjectivity, and that one is a vector, one is a vehicle, or one is something. So while I am completely opposed, like I draw upon religious and theological and other elements, I am a materialist. I am not. I do not hold with the category of the spiritual, etc. But I do hold with the idea of material agency of the dead, and I believe the song is in part the material agency of the dead, operative in the present, and exercising in a way that is not captured by notions of the psychoanalytic unconscious, etc., in a way that's doing something different. And I would link this a little bit to the earlier presentation in terms of a dimension of this, which I haven't mentioned, is to do with colonial modernity. Mm. And it is to do with, in colonial modernity, there's been a radical exclusion of the dead. And it used to be that the dead were partners in this world, and that is a feature of most traditional cultures. And the exclusion of the dead as property owners, the dead don't own property, so therefore they're not political agents, and therefore they do not have material force in the present. That actually is something that represents a unique departure within European colonial modernity, and something that I think requires some kind of reversal, that we need to revisit this idea. And that's a small dimension of this, but I don't know if I fully got to that, but it is a question of foregoing the notion of self-sufficient autonomy or complete embodiment. One's voice as a dimension of embodiment becomes inhabited by something more than oneself.
We'll move along to the next speaker. So, Jop, if you're ready to take the lectern. And once Jop has finished his presentation, we'll have time for a question or two, and then we'll have a little break for 10 minutes, I think. And then we'll come back for a panel discussion where you can also ask your burning questions. Okay?
Kan het licht uit? Okay. Yes, I agree a lot with Mike, and Yeah, the act of reading always involves a level of intimacy. And that level of intimacy, as a viewer, or as a reader, you can play with the volume, or you can turn up the intensity. And as a kid, I started reading and learning aphorism by heart. And for some reason, I put myself in a kind of position that the language put me in a different position, a kind of, it was transcending. And it was very intuitive. But sometimes you do things as a kid, and it never left me. So I'm going to do two poems. One poem of the Dutch poet Lucebert, and it's a nice occasion for the English people to hear Dutch. And the poem is called Lente zit er voor Lilith, Lucebert. Als baby zijn de dichters niet genezen van een eenzaam zoekend achterhoofd. Velen hebben liefde uitgedoofd om in duisternis haar licht te lezen. In duisternis is ieder even slecht. De buidel tederheid is spoedig leeg. Alleen wat dichters brengt het teweeg. Uit poelen worden lelies opgedrecht. Kappers slagen beter praters aan alles wat begraven is. Hey, God vergeet de dood van etels. Laat de zon uw zwarte vlekken merken dat het niet te laat is. Wie stralen wil moet branden, blijven branden als hij liefde meent. En jongens, en ik ben. Luister, ik jaag niet naar de letter. Ik jaag niet naar de letter. Maar ik luister. The second poem is an American classic. It's from Robert Frost. The Road Not Taken. Two roads diverged by yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both. And be one traveler long I stood, and looked down, went as far as I could, to where it bent in yonder crowd. Then took the other one as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same. And bow that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way. I doubt if I shall ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sign somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged by yellow wood, and I took the road less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. So, convinced of many poems drenched in my mind, I could make the following work. You see a detail. These are my favorite poems, and they are wrapped in a bouillon cubes. And it was a very simple and logical decision. Like bouillon, like broth, it has a very positive connotation. And it's a very essential material. And poetry is a kind of very essential text. So it was a very conceptual decision to cover the cubes with poetry, like transcending the text. It would be totally different if I covered it with candy. So it was a very... So and then, it's a little bit, the images are really bad, unfortunately. But I got an opportunity to make an exhibition. And eventually we got 120,000 cubes. And we found a school somewhere in Holland with 1,600 students. And on one day, everything was prepared. But on Friday, all the bouillon cubes came. Was spread out over the class, and already at 2 o'clock in the afternoon we had 100,000 cubes. So the walls were covered with the cube. Oh, one second. So it was a huge impact. And, well, the space was empty, but the impact was enormous. Then I did, this is my, I'm 22 years as an artist, and this is my second public, or my first public work in Holland. And this is in Rotterdam, and there is a canal. And so my proposal was to put a metal frame under the water, and there is a text on Samuel Beckett, no matter, try again, fail again, feel better. Those kind of sentences, like fail again, feel better, these are very constructive. For me, they work like a mantra, because it's not about perfectness, but it's like starting over again. So the work was like... So there was a metal frame, there was a text on the water, everything was connected with a blower, and then every 5 minutes the blower was running, and you could see the text, and after a couple of minutes the text was not there. It was for me very important to make it like that every time you repeat a sentence. That was the content of the work. And it's still there. This is another work. Later in my career, I discovered the Dutch philosopher Spinoza. It took me a long time to understand him. But once you begin to understand the richness of his words and the intelligence, and he only wrote 4 books, but his most famous is The Ethics in Geometrical Order. And he was the first philosopher who was aware of human emotions and that those human emotions always were there. And he put them in a kind of formulas, like mathematical formulas. And when you first read his books, it's very difficult. But once you begin to understand it, it's fantastic. So I did a piece for him. So on the ground, I covered the book, The Ethica, all the pages. I glue it to the ground. Then I made these patterns, and I filled it with my assistant with sand, and it's like a mandala. And if you get close to the work, the images are turning. So this is like, the image is not so nice, okay. It's also very important in my artistic career that the idea of representation is a very, very big issue. So I am always work on location. So to make an image or a photo of this work, so it should be happen on location. This is my recent show in the gallery. Excuse me for the image. But there are 5, in the corner you see 5 panels. And every panel consists of contradiction. One like dedication means authority. Another one is like every decision is a final refusal. Nothing feels like success. Opposition is true friendship. And these are like my poems. These are mantras which I'm repeating all the time. So in the exhibition, we start making drawings, and every time repeating the drawings, and then you create the several effects. The images are really bad, excuse. So this is a big one on the path. That's a beautiful one from Krishnamurti, Passion Without Motive. Once your energy becomes like that, then you deal with a different level. That's one of the first things you can learn from Spinoza, the idea of causality. As long as you're in the process of causality, it's you're losing energy. It only becomes important when you start break the chain of causality, which is a very long process. And very difficult. So passion without motive, then you have broken the chain. You feel energy, not because you have to do something, but you feel it from inside. So these mantras are for me. Yes, these are like these are chains, are treasures. They're also on the image, but they're also very aesthetics. I put in a lot of a pressure in my artistic career on aesthetics. It should also be beautiful, because beauty is also energy. This is a kind of, can you see what it is? These are books with cassette tapes. And on, every decision is a final refusal. But on the 1st of February 2006, I made an ethical decision in my work, because, well, I was also reading books, and when I went to art school, influenced by modernism, I had a table, and I had always five books on my table, on different pages, and for many years, I was doing zap reading. And a lot of people like that. It was like how you watch TV, like zapping. So I was reading a book on page 17, and I jumped to another. And it, for a moment, it felt very good. But then at a certain point, I began to lose the language. So then on the 1st of February 2006, I said to myself, the most difficult thing you can do now to open a book and read the whole book, because you didn't do it for 10 years, and also, I'm going to tape it, and I'm going to do it for 45 minutes, one side of a cassette tape. Very influenced by the Taoists, they say that the moment you begin to understand that you can work without effort, if you begin to understand that, that's unity in your mind. So actually, it was a very good decision to read 45 minutes. Because I made a statement on the 1st of February, but on the 2nd I didn't read. And on the 5th I start again. But after the fourth book, I began to understand the richness and to understand the discipline. And now I'm doing that process for 11 years, and it's, I'm addicted. Because it's also like, I'm always reading in the morning. It's 74 minutes actually, and 20 seconds. But it's like, I'm reading out loud is also, the Buddhists say if you have a mantra and you say it out loud many times, the resonation of your own voice makes that the blood in your brain get more circulation. There's a little bit more oxygen. But a little tiny bit more oxygen in your brain is a lot. So not the first one year and a half, but later on. So now if I'm reading in the morning after 45 minutes, I feel a little bit like I'm stoned, and it's really crazy. So if a book has 500 pages, there are 26 tapes. But the thing is, before when it was a book was very thick, you said, I have to read a thick book. But now, because I read 45 minutes, I turn around the process. Only that is already, and it's a very mechanical decision. But the mechanical decision, because it was so short, it's always feel fresh. Isn't that crazy? No, but it's. So now I'll come a little bit to the product with the students, because after 10 years reading, because I'm listening back, but I felt the need, I'm still losing too much. So now from all the books I'm listening back, and I'm making audiobooks with CDs, so to get more of the language. And I know Hank for a couple of years, and he saw the books in my studio. And you cannot ask people to read on cassette tapes, because it's a little bit outdated. But people can read their own book, and we did a project with the students. And for me it was fantastic to share it with other people. And the students took very ambitious books. So maybe someone can tell about the projects, because they told nice stories. Who wants to tell something about his book? you know, come on.
Did, can I ask a question? Did you read each other's books? No. Have you listened to each other's books?
A little bit, doch.
You can say something, no?
Yeah, yeah, there's a nice, they all have nice stories.
Say something about our works, right?
You told me a you told me a beautiful story about this mummy.
My book was in the first one with some pieces, glasses, a mirror on the cover. And I think the process is very interesting because it's just like you said, it's a kind of practicing discipline myself, my everyday. So I actually 2 years ago, I did the same things every day, like writing the diary every day and then keep it for 1 year, and I published the diary every day to the public in the Chinese kind of social application, so everybody can read my diary every day. It's very, in the end, same, I'm starting to addict it with it. Yeah, so and then I come here, I start with a project. I think it's really similar. I push myself every day into the 45 minutes, and then, yeah, at the beginning it's very, you know, I hate it. But later, why not? Just keep going. And later on, I started addicted with it. Okay, I want to do more things. Go deep with it. I want to drawing. I want to destroy my book. I want to find a lot of way to creation, right? To create books. So I reflect myself. It's quite different changing during the process at the beginning and the end. It's quite different. So that's why I joined my book. Black and white.
His mama told him about the Greeks.
Talking about the Iliad of Homer, the book's name. Yeah, I'm talking. It's talking about the death, talking about war, talking about the tricks, talking about everything. So I draw lots of images, which is really interesting in, like some dead people, some lots of the discussion, lots of the God. Normal people, everything combined to the world. So I'm interested in that, so I joined the images on the books. That's my understanding of the project. Yeah.
We have time for some questions, if you like. Are you ready, Jop, for us to open it up to questions?
Yeah.
Yeah?
maybe it's good to elaborate a bit on this project as an educational tool, because we have been discussing about art education, and at a certain moment you suggested that it could be a very constructive tool for, another understanding of critical studies, because we know already reading groups, reading out loud, all kinds of, you know, modes in education, and you suggested it as a new way of treating books. So I think it's important also to discuss that aspect.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's not a new way, because it could be a very old way, but first of all, it's a nice exercise, and it was nice for the art students, because when they have to talk about their own work, they have to think about sometimes difficult issues, and they couldn't find the words. But if you read a book of a philosopher, and the content is provided, I told them, the content of the book is provided, stick to that. But you can make nice drawings, so you don't have to think about what are my emotions, the emotions. And it could be, for me, it's sometimes a relief that to read a book of a good philosopher. It's like an exercise. Words like discipline, it's like, I have two kids, and 2 weeks ago there was a meeting about them, a meeting like that for 2 hours. And actually it was all about discipline, and nobody had the guts to say the word, and then I said, is this about discipline? Yeah, careful. No, but I'm reading 11 books now, of 11 years. Marcus Aurelius, Nietzsche, Spinoza. There is one axis. If you want to start something with your life, it starts with self-discipline. It doesn't change. And I think yeah, reading these days on schools, it's terrible. So maybe there is a kind of, it's not something new, but reinventing. And it's just like a practice, like mathematics, like history. You read a book, we have all the tools. You know, for example, I have an intellectual alibi of 11 years. You can check me. The intellectual piece can stop me. He said, why did you read on the 8th of February 2010? So for me, it's like, I want to, what Dutch politicians, what do they read? They don't read books. It could be a nice issue. Because thinking itself, it's the most magnificent thing we have. So it's more like, what's going on? Everybody's like, if you talk with those kids, do we have to buy a CD? You know, it's like Steve Jobs, man. it's like, of course, I have a computer too and all those things, but reading is still reading and thinking is still thinking. So it would be nice to make it a tradition, and I'm talking with other schools. It's just an exercise. It's not like a metaphysical, just like work. I feel it's very pragmatic.
Yeah.
The rest, the other things will come.
One of the things that was really nice listening to the recordings of the students reading was when you realized, for example, there was one moment where you realized that the person reading the text hadn't read it before. And they laughed at one of the sentences that they were reading, as if suddenly discovering that what they were reading was really hilarious. Or when you hear somebody stumble over a sentence and then swear, or you hear somebody questioning kind of the pronunciation of something, and all of those different textures of all of these different voices while you're looking at the images and also trying to read what's written, because you were also very prolific in writing in the books that you made. While we're listening, we're looking at texts that are not related necessarily directly to what's being told to us. So this is kind of intertextual.
Yeah, but that's kind of a nice issue, because I wasn't aware of that after 2 or 3 years reading, because I'm reading homemade. But so I was reading, and nobody did care. But then I was doing home reading, but sometimes there was a sound. And then suddenly I became aware, because I have a lot of audiobooks from all the big publishers. But actually it's really crazy, because you never hear the sound of the page. You never hear, it's like, oh, nice. Actually, it's very mechanical. And even if you listen to the whole book, sometimes an actor, and he's paid for 20 hours. I know one book, he reads Dostoevsky, and at the end, he starts reading faster and faster. So it's like, what is this? Yeah, Dostoevsky was walking down the street. So it's totally mechanical. So I became aware, hey, because I'm thinking, I'm repeating sentences. So I told to the students, it's homemade. If there's a mistake, it's fantastic.
And you can calibrate the centimeters left with the amount of time that
But isn't
have
that
left.
Crazy? That all those big, it's very mechanical. They got paid for 30 hours. Hmm. But never you hear the page, never you hear like, oh, never the same sentence. So it could be something like rediscovering.
On that note, I think we need to take our break for 10 minutes. Please don't leave. Come back for the panel discussion. It'll be fabulous, I promise. And this is just a little break to stretch your legs and do whatever businesses you need to do. Smoke your cigarettes, check your phones, and so forth. Okay, see you in a minute. So maybe I will just sort of launch this with a really kind of basic question, because it's always kind of the task of the moderator to find some common ground between the speakers. And you all, there are two things that came to mind. You are all interested in the fragment as a form, either the fragment of a bullion cube that becomes an installation, or the fragment of knowledge embodied in an image, or the fragment of a song that can generate bodies singing together. And so I wondered if you might speak a little bit to this role that the fragment plays conceptually and materially in your practice. And then a second question would have to do with the fact, and this is also something maybe for the room, because it relates also to the students' work with the audiobooks, is this question of translation. And because we're all dealing with the Bach text in translation in English, we're speaking in English, but there are lots of different languages, lots of different linguistic knowledges in this room that aren't represented in the way that we're speaking with each other. And I think the fact that you read the poem in Dutch and then a poem in English is another way to sort of broach the questions. So either, if you want to answer either one, that's fine, or fragments and translations. Don't be shy. All the hard stuff is over.
Yeah, you.
I don't get a whole. Can you be more specific about? You said fragments, but.
For example, you take a fragment of a text by. Sorry? Yeah, by Seamus Heaney, or a fragment of a text by Beckett. Yeah. And you make those fragments public in a particular way in your practice.
Okay, what shall I say about those things? Well, my artist practice is like, it has nothing to do with distortion, but all my, because we only saw five or six works, but all my work is about the intensification of the. And it's always a fragment, a very specific fragmentic work I did was like, I did an intervention in a gallery. It took me 2 years to convince him, but it was a very specific work. And I convinced the gallerist to make a wall in the gallery, the size of a soccer goal, and behind it was a beautiful garden. And that was a very specific fragment, and it was a very simple idea, but the idea was very beautiful, and it was, again, reality was there, and I took away. Yeah, normally you bring something to the gallery, but I took something away, and suddenly you have a strong sense of reality. But that was, that was typical of fragments, and it was about intensification. You heard me say some poems, and I did it long before I was an artist, and it still gives me energy, and it gives me strength. It's like a little bit like shamanistic, but shamanistic light, not shamanistic. But I also don't feel the need to be to expose it. Well, I'm doing here poems, but I don't feel the need to say like you should do that too. Or that's not in nature. You don't see that in nature. So for me, it's a little bit different.
Okay, I think this working with Camilla for me, I think, has a lot to do with somehow trying to becoming more comfortable with the fragmentation of things. I think Camilla for herself is very comfortable with gaps. Me in my work, usually I try to show like what is between the fragments and to try to at least articulate a way of how things go from one place to the other. And here in this project, because this also has to do, I think, with translation, because there are certain things that cannot be translated, that just need to exist, and there's still a resonance between them, but it is not articulatable in words. So I think this is what I would think about if I think about fragments more than the fragment of knowledge in the image, but I would think more about the whole conversation that we are having and how things can, but at the same time, how things can, and this is why Mix, your presentation was very inspiring, because I think it talks also about something that is transmitted, which is not articulatable, which does not have to do with, let's just say, this production of subjectivity, which is also so much articulated by these modern texts in which we are living, basically, but something else that is not, that also does not need to be, needs only to be experienced, maybe, but not, you are not looking for a way probably either to formulate or to verbalize what it is that is transmitting something.
I there was something you said about the what was happening at the moment in this stage of the work, that this was the first, or this was the beginning, or this, so this was something, but it wasn't everything. Mm. And there might never be an everything, I'm just wondering, the ontology of the fragment suggests there is completion. There's a fragment of something. I don't think it maybe doesn't inevitably have to do that, but it tends to do that. That this is a part of the whole.
Whereas also, I think, citation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And but I'm wondering if the idea of maybe incompletion, which, okay, so it posits the possibility of completion. It will fold in and be completed later, but there is the sense of something which, it's in process. It's becoming, but it is not. It does not have a terminus or a point of completion. So it's incomplete without positing completion. And I guess this is to do with doing something as a mode of inquiry rather than as a mode of expression or a mode of simply production. I think inquiry has this. This might go nowhere. This might not be something. This is. You know, so I think there's so both fragment and translation have in them, I think, some suggestion that there is something which there is a wholeness or there is a completeness to be transferred or to of which you get a glimpse or a part. Whereas I think that the sense I get from what we've each been doing is that there isn't the sense that there is this complete perfect thing to be found or to be transported from one place to another. But I'm sure this could be said much more articulately.
No, you said something about singing out loud. That's nice. But can you elaborate a little bit on, but is that like a practicing in the back room or?
Well, I think it's interesting that singing would retreat into the bathroom, you know. Mm. I mean, I don't have any empirical on this except anecdotal, but it seems to me it would just be normal for us to hum and sing. That's just a normal part of embodied existence.
It's liberating. It's like, it feels good.
But I think, like, as you walk or skip, I don't. Mm-hmm. I think that, yes, these are acquired, these are culturally acquired behaviours, and they're tuned to a cultural context. But pretty much walking and skipping is something that bodies do. And I think humming and singing is something that bodies do. But it's something that the bodies within a particular form of colonial modernity are not doing. And where it is being done, it's being done in a highly dissociated, abstracted, reduced way. And that seems to me, in terms of aesthesis, in terms of bodily sensing and being in the world and bodily attunement to other bodies, it seems singing is such a fundamental dimension of that. Singing, dancing, speaking, that they seem, you know.
Colonial modernity?
Yeah, I mean, it's a term that I'm taking from, I'm taking it from the decolonial theorists, where they posit that you can't say modernity and imagine that the European Enlightenment is somehow a self-contained thing. If you want to understand the European Enlightenment, you must look to the colonial project, and then it makes sense. So we have Enlightenment only as a dimension of coloniality. Modernity only as a dimension of coloniality, and we have coloniality as the fundamental dimension of modernity. And I mean, I thought this was, I find this very interesting in the
in the way you were talking about working in relation to the image, so these two images and how they interacted, that not seeking, like somehow wanting a relationship of the Iberian and or the Dutch and the Brazilian, but not wanting to have that as a mastery from one to the other, but, and also understanding that this dialectic of self and other could not be so simple, or you know, it's problematic.
Mm. So, and what's the opposite of colonial modernity?
Well, I don't know that the project of decolonialism, as I understand it, is not to have an opposite of European colonial modernity, but rather not to define oneself in relation to European modernity, but rather, you know, the idea is South-South. The idea is positions that are not oriented towards Berlin or London or Frankfurt or...
We don't have any other option. We have to be modern. Is there any other option?
I think there must be other options. I think to say that there are no other options is to override the fact that for centuries people have been engaged in resistance, that there is continuity of resistance, and that's not about essentialism. That's just a fact. There are people who have been in resistance.
We should, but it's very difficult.
I don't think this means that you disavow modernity in the sense that you go, okay, let's get rid of the toasters and the electricity, and you know,
no,
we might get rid of the toasters, but I think it is a matter of saying that the epistemological shrinkage that was enacted in European modernity, whereas a singular model of knowing the world becomes prescriptive and dominant and excludes other ways of knowing the world. That kind, we don't have to settle for that shrinkage.
I think this is also one of the reasons why we're looking at that image, because it's not that this was already, at the moment that this was produced, this project was not finished yet. So after this image was made, this colonial modernity, the establishing of these readings have continued, and we thought that maybe you need to break down somehow something of these readings from 1835 till now, which have reinforced this idea, these like positions of subjectivity, the Western subject, and all these things, which were not existing as strongly then as they were now, even if the colonial project was like very completely like going on, but it's not that it has not, like humanism and all these things have contributed again still. So I think this is also something that we want to question, like how are we still continuing on this on this route of this colonial modernity. We need to understand exactly when we fall into the traps of this.
Hi. I actually want to listen to
this.
Ich hanne, louder. A little bit louder.
When you proposed incompleteness and so on, I just wanted to maybe counter-propose openness, because incompleteness still continues to be the other of the standard of completeness and so on. And then since your conversation veered off into post-colonial, decolonial direction, maybe I do need to say that the openness concept term was proposed by Umberto Eco with his prime example of James Joyce's Finnegan's Wake as very much a minor literature, decolonial post, anticipating post-colonial literature. And I think it's also something that could relate to Mick, how you were trying to sort of push Bart further into the direction of opening up the seminar even further to how he explained it, into something where the exegesis that becomes text turns into something that performs and something bodily, and you know, where the toing and froing between being and text production and enjoyment and scholarship and all of those things are intertwined.
I'm just thinking, for a lot of musicians, this would be maybe this is something they might take for granted, that within the process of collectively inquiring or working together to learn, that they would move in and out of different modes of commentary, of reading, of performing, of enacting, of making music together, and improvising or rehashing things or whatever. But that the move between, basically, the seminar is a practical mode of production, and not simply as not simply as a mode of attending to the text or what may be elaborated further on the text or what text may yet be to come. But I wonder about the openness thing, because you're completely correct that in positing incompletion, it is a negation of completion, so you're left with the problem. But so the fragment is a classic kind of romantic kind of aesthetic category. So I wonder if there's something maybe in the difference between a song and a poem, or a song and a novel, that there's something about the way in which, when the song is not being sung, it has a continued material existence that I think is different from a book, a novel, and maybe a poem is a midway, because you had some poems that were not in text, but they suddenly were in the room because you were carrying them in a particular way. But I think if we start to think about materialities other than the ones that we are familiar with, that are inscribed around the paradigms of the book as a kind of primary, the book, the type, those, you know. But I don't have the language of it resolved.
We have time for one more question.
Just an elaboration of what you just said, because actually thinking about Barthes, to bring it back to Barthes, he also had this text where he talks about speaking in public and how when you're given a talk in public that your words kind of hang in the room like a smell, and then afterwards you have this feeling, this kind of ugh feeling, like ugh, because you don't have control over what you said and it wasn't contained and you haven't perfected and it's not captured in a text. I think Barthes was very sensitive to that, and before you even move into the musical body, then the oral production in the seminar already for Barthes moved in that direction. So I just had to remember that when you talk about the song.
I think the embarrassing hang of words spoken in public, left hanging like a smell in the air, is the perfect note to end on.
And especially that they continue to hang because we've recorded everything. So you can smell them forever, as long as you like. Repeat. Yeah? Well, if there are no further questions, we can continue by conversing upstairs. Thank you.